truly seated now. We welcome you. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Community in Citrus Heights. We welcome those of you who are viewing our live stream on Facebook. And we welcome those who may have joined us on Zoom this morning. I know, we may be a small community church just like home, but we're also high tech. So, greetings one and all. Let us open our service by sharing today's daily word. And today is Sunday, March 27th, 2022. And the words for today are divine order. Divine order supports my life. Divine order is one of the great truths of life. It provides a foundation for all growth and a blueprint for all manifestation. Feeling stuck or bewildered is a sign that I am out of step with divine order. I pause, and with compassion for myself, I release thoughts of worry, impatience, and doubt. I remind myself of times when I wondered whether a hoped-for result would ever happen, only to realize, in hindsight, that foundational aspects had to be in place first. Remembering this helps me be patient and trusting now. I affirm, I cooperate with divine order. It is established in my life now. I cooperate with divine order. It is established in my life now. I listen with mind and heart, trusting that I will discern my path one step at a time. And the scripture for today is from Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not rely on your own insight. And the words for today are divine order. And now we invite you to join us in singing. What are we singing now?
Seek ye first.
Seek ye first.
Seek ye first the kingdom of God.
To Sunday featurette.
And if you're new to this church, maybe I should explain a couple of things. We have a short, sometimes shorter than others, featurette, and then later we have a talk. And sometimes they support each other in a theme, and sometimes they just don't. The other thing I want you to know is that Unity is a metaphysical organization. We interpret the Bible metaphysically, and we describe ourselves as metaphysical Christianity. One of the components of the classical study of metaphysics is cosmology, and that is the study of the planets and space and time and what's going on in the sky right now. And we do, more often than you might think, include information, both astronomical and astrological. And today is one of those days. Right now, in the sky, there is so much happening that is amazing. And it is what they call a stellium of planets. It's almost like this picture where the planets are all lined up. And from Earth, it looks like they're in a big clump. If you have two planets that are lined up that way, it's called a conjunction. And then if you get a bunch more planets that are close to each other, they use the word stellium. And so we look at, I had the best time doing the PowerPoint for today, let me tell you. We look at the orbits in motion. And this has the Sun, and then Mercury, Venus, Earth with the Moon, and Mars. And it starts over again. It only covers about a year. And then it starts over again. And this, as you can see, with the orbits indicated with the circles, this tells us two things. First of all, this is just the emblem of where the PowerPoint slide was provided from. So that's not a new sun that's appearing on the horizon that you need to worry about. What this tells us, first of all, is about the ecliptic. That the planets, all of them except Pluto, which may be one of the reasons Pluto's on the outs now, they orbit the sun in a plane. As if you put a plate through the sun and all the planets are orbiting like a record player, like a record. And that plane is called the ecliptic. That word comes up a lot. But you've never seen a picture that had the sun in the middle and planets scattered all over the place going every which way or not. You always see it this way because it is this way. The second thing to know about this slide is we have the Earth here. And then there's Venus, and then there's Mars. Well, from the Earth, they look like they're one star, one planet. Because Mars is behind Venus right now. That's a conjunction. People may say a conjunction is when two planets are in the same place. Well, you know they're not really in the same place. It's just that from Earth, they are lined up, one behind the other. And this is another illustration of the Mars-Venus conjunction. It's just a prettier picture. This is going on right now. This is going on in more. Venus is the morning star right now, and I was sending everybody out an hour before dawn to look at it and saying, it is so bright, you won't believe it's real. Well, Venus is bright, but it was even brighter because it was Venus and Mars together. So we see here the Earth and Venus and Mars lined up as an illustration of the Venus and Mars conjunction. Now, when we start diagramming these things, you see that we have the plane of the ecliptic here with all the orbits of the planets. And around them, 12 signs of the zodiac, which are each constellations, which are truly around this ecliptic equator. And again, we see the Earth here, and there's the Sun. And from the Earth, these little dotted lines are showing you how all the different planets are lined up and how they look from the Earth. And if you look at, like this is Saturn right there, and this particular diagram has Saturn, I think that's in Pisces. But that's only because when you're looking from the Earth, that's the constellation that's behind Saturn. Okay, now look at this. This is the same diagram. But instead of having pictures of the animals and the signs of the zodiac, it actually is saying these are the constellations. And their names, which are the signs of the zodiac. And the Earth, I think I need a new battery. The Sun. And this belt, you see how it creates like a belt, is the zodiac. If you look up the definition of the word zodiac, it tells you it is this belt that goes around the ecliptic, and it's 8 degrees on either side of the ecliptic, but within this belt are all these different constellations. It all comes together. It really does. Now, brace yourself. So we take this and we put it on paper. And it becomes two-dimensional. It's a wheel. But it, you see, it's the same thing. There's 12 divisions here. And there's 12 signs around. And it's a way of representing what's going on in the sky in a two-dimensional form where we can work with it, where we can make connections with it, and figure out how things are and how they look. So knowing this in a very basic way, and what led us to this diagram, leads us to this. This is where the action is, guys. This is a chart. This is an astrological chart. And if you see, it's not as pretty as the one before it, but it looks very much the same. It's got 12 divisions, and it's got planets where they are in the sky. I took this picture at 6:57 a.m. this morning. I told my phone to turn on a timer so that I could capture it on an app I've got and say, this is what it looked like at sunrise today. And what is so outstanding is this little piece in here, because that's the Moon and Mars and Venus and Saturn, and they are all in Aquarius. And if we look just a little bit further, we have Jupiter and Neptune in Pisces. And that's called a stellium. Remember we said we've got a bunch of planets clumped together? It's called a stellium. And it's in the morning sky right now. Now I wanted to quickly compare this, and Lisa gave me permission, to her natal chart. If you were born today, if you were born at 6:57 today, that last chart we looked at would be your natal chart. Because in astrology, when they talk about, you know, your birth chart, it is a picture of what was in the sky the moment you were born. So the picture of what was in the sky when Lisa was born, you see the balance in this chart?
Yes.
You see the planets are all around the wheel. We got a lot going on. We got bunch of different signs all balancing, interacting, and reflecting on each other. And so when you see a chart like this, and then look at something like this, you understand that this is really different. It doesn't happen that often.
Neither does a person like Lisa happen that often. All right, so that's all the charts you have to look at. Breathe. You know, this isn't hard. I taught Ashley, although I made her memorize all those glyphs, you should see her. This is a diagram of March 28th tomorrow and March 27th today. This is real-time stuff. And it's the horizon. That green line is the horizon because it's right before sunrise. And it shows how Venus has risen, and then Mars and Saturn are going to rise, and the moon, we have a crescent moon, which is also in Aquarius right now. And that's how that would all look. The sun rose today at 6:57 a.m. So this is probably how it looked at 6 o'clock. Okay. It's not hard to find this information on the net. You can find the time that every planet rises and sets. This is how I do it. Google is my friend. Another view of that same time shows the moon and Saturn and Venus and Mars. This isn't as good a picture. And that is going to be tomorrow morning, 45 minutes before sunrise. Now last but not least, we have another news. You should see me. I was beyond control yesterday with these slides. This is showing a two-week period from March the 15th through March the 31st. And that little one that's moving from the right to the left is the moon. And it's a loop. So it's showing the moon, and once it gets down there, it starts over again. It's showing that same two-week period with the motion of those rising planets, Venus and Mars and Saturn, as the moon comes across the sky too. And thus ends our feature. God bless you. Now we're going to sing up, 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 right?
Up, up, up to a higher place.
Place I feel my soul.
bless the prayer requests, both those that are in our hearts and those that we have a prayer box in the lobby. We have some slips that you can find, fill out with the name, with your prayer requests. And those prayer requests are taken by me or other prayer chaplains and prayed over and sent to, the names are sent to Silent Unity where they're prayed over for 30 days. So we invite you to do that. Also, I'm available today for individual prayer after the service. So just come up to me, and even if I don't look like I'm standing like prayer chaplain there, just I love to pray with you. So I'm open to that. And so at this moment, let us take those prayer requests into our field of love, our field of knowing, knowing that there is divine order. As we were brought our attention, as our attention was brought to in our daily word today, knowing that no matter what we may feel about what is going on in the world or what is going on in our lives, that God's order is greater than any feeling or belief we may have. So we can just rest in that peace and that knowing, enfolded in love this morning, and we release our prayer requests into the loving care of the Christ consciousness. Thank you, God. Amen. Please join me in preparing for a time of meditation.
Take a moment to become comfortable. Take a couple of deep breaths. Our meditation today is taken from lesson number 50 of A Course in Miracles. And as we enter this time of meditation, say silently to yourself, I am sustained by the love of God. This is the answer to every problem that will confront you today and tomorrow and throughout time. In this world, you believe you are sustained by everything but God. Your faith is placed in the most mundane and meaningless symbols, in pills and money and protective clothing, prestige, being liked, and an endless list of forms of nothingness that you endow with magical powers. All these things are your replacements for the love of God. Do not put your faith in the things of the world. They will not sustain you. Only the love of God will protect you in all circumstances. It will lift you out of every trial and raise you high above all the perceived dangers of this world into a climate of perfect peace and safety. It will transport you into a state of mind that nothing can threaten, nothing can disturb, and where nothing can intrude upon the eternal calm of the sons and daughters of God. Put not your faith in illusions, they will fail you. Put all your faith in the love of God within you, eternal, changeless, and forever unfailing. This is the answer to whatever confronts you today. Through the love of God within you, you can resolve all seeming difficulties without effort and in sure confidence. Tell yourself this often today. It is a declaration of release from the belief in idols. It is your acknowledgement of the truth about yourself. Repeat once again. I am sustained by the love of God, and allow peace to flow over you like a blanket of protection and faith as we share some time in the silence. Such is the kingdom of heaven. Such is the resting place where your Creator has placed you now and forevermore. Thank you. go over 5 or 10 minutes today, so if you have to leave, leave, but it's just too good to cut anything out. So I'm going to relax and enjoy myself, and I hope you do also. Today we're looking at some of the parables of Jesus, and we realize that they contain only one lesson. And that lesson is taught in many different ways. That lesson is that we are one with God and we are one with each other. Jesus came to teach us the truth about who we are and to tell us that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is the state of consciousness in which we are aware of and living from our inner divinity. And the great teachings of the world agree on this basic principle that the outer world is an illusion, and that looking to the outer world for our good leads us to suffering. That God is within us. That God is very accessible to us. Examples of these ideas come from in Buddhism and in the way of the Four Noble Truths. They come from Hinduism with the illusion of Maya. They come from A Course in Miracles. If you think about our meditation today, which was pure Course in Miracles. And they come from Christianity. So we read from Matthew 16:26. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? And then we read from Matthew 6:31. This is my favorite scripture. Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Didn't we sing that today? Yes, we did. Today we're going to talk about a trio of parables that are all about the kingdom of heaven. And they're all from the Gospel of Matthew. The first one is from Matthew 44. And it says, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So we interpret this as this hidden treasure, the treasure that's hidden in the field is the truth of your inner divinity. That's the treasure of you. And it's hidden in the last place you would look, inside you. And when we find it, it is still hidden because it can only be found within us. In our consciousness, we find it through prayer and meditation. And when we find it, it brings us great joy because it is the source of joy. We sell all we have, and that means we release the things of the world. And we buy that field where the hidden treasure is buried, which means we take up residence in the kingdom through our beliefs and the righteous living that these beliefs lead us to. The second parable is also from Matthew 13. And Jesus said, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. So, where do you find pearls?
Inside a field.
hidden within oysters, or within your consciousness, of course. And when we find that one pearl, the truth of us, we release all that we have, meaning we deny the beliefs that the world can provide us happiness. And we buy that pearl. We affirm beliefs that we are sustained by the love of God. And from Acts 17:28, we read, "In him we live and move and have our being," literally, now and forevermore. I was going to share a real life application of this with you. It happened to me just yesterday morning. I saw two doctors and a veterinarian this week. 10 tubes of blood that those little suckers took from me. The doctor, in my humble opinion, was not very helpful. And the veterinarian charged $500 for the tests that would lead to the surgery that would be $1,000. So that was Friday. And I was lying in bed yesterday morning, and often lying in bed in the morning, I have some of my greatest insights, if I don't allow myself to circle the drain of despair. And I was lying in bed, and I realized how frustrated I felt, and how I felt like I was a victim of our health care system and the pet care system. And so I was planning to send Lisa a text and say, "I have three things to say. Number one, the doctors are idiots. Number two, the veterinarians are pirates. And number three, how do I reconcile my experience and my feelings with the metaphysical principles that I know to be true?" And number three was the pearl of great value, that when I looked at my feelings and my beliefs, then I knew that the problem was me. How do oysters form pearls? They are protecting themselves from irritants. And when life presents us with challenging circumstances, the ones that get our attention because of the discomfort they cause, it's like the pearl of truth that makes us examine our beliefs and take responsibility for our experiences. If a situation makes us feel victimized, it's because we believe we can be victims. And that's a false belief. That's what we call in unity an error thought, an error belief, an erroneous belief. This realization is the pearl of great value. It is because it reveals to us what is in our consciousness, and it gives us the opportunity to see things differently. And that leads us to the third parable that we're discussing today. Again, from Matthew 13. Jesus said again, "The kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets and threw out the bad." I think about this a lot. I think about this net a lot. This is about discernment and renunciation. Discernment and renunciation. Our minds are like the net that we throw into the sea of consciousness. And we collect thoughts of every kind, and we are exposed to teachings of every kind. It is up to us to examine our thoughts and our beliefs and to sort through them and keep the good ones and reject the erroneous ones. In so doing,
We are exhibiting mastery over life. Mastery over life. Mastery over life is a tricky concept. You think about the word mastery, it means you think you're going to have to show up and take charge, right? Mastery is much more about surrender. Yesterday I was watching, I've been binge watching The West Wing again. I think it is the best series that was ever on TV. It just takes my breath away. And I heard this story about a pilot. And the person telling this story says, new pilots will go up in their planes, and they've been well trained. They know what the instruments are for. They know what the readings on the instruments mean. But they fly into a bank of clouds and they can't see. They can't see around them where they are, where's up, where's down, where's north, where's south. And even though the instruments tell them all those things, where's north, where's up, how high are you? They start doubting the instruments and start making manual corrections. And the man telling this story said, you would be amazed at the number of new pilots who fly out of cloud banks and they are upside down. That is the art of surrender. We have our instruments. We have our basic principles. We know that God is good all the time. We know we are divine. We know our thoughts create our reality. But we get into situations where we can't see that in the world. We look out the window, we might see clouds, or no matter what we see, it doesn't look like God is good all the time. It doesn't look like every person is divine or they are all one with us, even though our instruments tell us that that's the truth. And so mastery over life comes from remembering what you know is true and surrendering to it regardless of what is going on around you. People, including probably me and probably you, labor long and miserably under false assumptions. We believe that we are separate from God and from each other. This belief is the cause of war, of famine, of victimization, of all suffering. When a basic belief, a basic assumption is false, everything that springs from it is meaningless. And a lot of beliefs will spring from a base assumption and lead you all kinds of strange places. And one of my favorite characters on the old Saturday Night Live show was Emily Latella. She was played by Gilda Radner and on a segment called Weekend Update. And she would come on, this sweet little lady, and she would say something like, what's all this I hear about shaving the whales? Well, how do they catch the whales? What kind of razors would you use on a whale? Do the whales like being shaved? Can the whales swim after they've been shaved? Do the whales get cold because they've been shaved? And about that time, Chevy Chase is like tapping her on the shoulder, going, Miss Latella, they're not talking about shaving the whales. They're talking about saving the whales. And so she gets this look on her face and she goes, oh, never mind. But you see, the false assumption, the shaving the whales, led to all of these meaningless questions. Those questions had no meaning, didn't matter at all, because they sprang from an erroneous base assumption. It's a wonderful lesson. We go through life asking meaningless questions. We ask questions about what shall we wear? What shall we eat? What shall we drink? How can we succeed? How can we gain recognition? How do you win at love? And how can we find joy? The questions are meaningless because they are based on a wrong assumption. They are based on the assumption that we are separate from God, and that we can somehow have our needs met and our desires satisfied by the things of the world. There's another part in A Course in Miracles. If you're not familiar with those teachings, you should talk to us during the stay and chat today. I know there's more than one person here that's read this as I have also. This is lesson 23. This changed my life the first time I read it, this very lesson. It says, there is no point in lamenting the world. There is no point in lamenting the world. There is no point in trying to change the world. The world is incapable of change because it is merely an effect. It is merely an effect. We create the world with our beliefs. And the world faithfully mirrors back our error thinking and our misassumptions. And A Course in Miracles also states that joy is the indication that you are finding God. Now I want to share some ideas about forgiveness. The kingdom of heaven is based on unconditional love and forgiveness. We talk about the need for forgiveness a lot in Unity. Your unforgiveness keeps you bound to the ways of the world. As long as you believe that someone has harmed you, betrayed you, disappointed you, or stolen from you, you are still believing that the world exists separate from your beliefs. You are still making the world the source of your good and the source of the bad and the source of your suffering. It's only when we surrender into God's peace that we are free from suffering. With everything, every person that you refuse to forgive, you are chaining yourself to an illusion. I could read that again and say, with everything, every person that I refuse to forgive, I am chaining myself to an illusion. No one can take your good from you. God is your source. God is your only source. And so this week, I encourage you to observe what thoughts the net of your mind catches and returns to you. To sort through those thoughts, discarding negativity, unforgiveness, and error thinking. To spend some time wrapped in the warmth of God's comfort and love as you sit in the silence. And to know that you are loved beyond measure, now and forevermore. And thus ends the lesson.
which helps this ministry thrive and bless the world. We ask our ushers to go ahead and pass the offering basket. And please do know that it is your support that allows us to have this ministry. You may make your offerings here at service, or we also have a P.O. Box 2176 in Citrus Heights. Or we have a donate button on our website, and many people like to set up scheduled donations, and you can do that through that service also. So let us join now together in blessing our offerings with Unity's prosperity prayer, knowing that divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I choose to give, and all that I am open to receive. So it is. Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lisa. We have a few announcements this morning. The newsletter that went out Friday or Saturday has the April calendar in it, so we've got the whole month planned out. Next week, we'll be meeting again back here at the Sylvan Community Center. I will be in Florida visiting my 92-year-old mother, finally. And Lisa will be sharing a talk called And God Laughed with a guest musician, Melissa Olson. And then the next week, on Palm Sunday, which is April the 10th, we'll be back on Zoom. This is always on the calendar. I know right now it might be difficult to keep up with. We try to meet twice a month here at the Community Center and twice on Zoom. We consider ourselves a hybrid church. But if there were ever a time in history when everything was in transition, it's now. And so that's what we're going to do for April. We'll let you know what we're going to do for May. On Palm Sunday, Lisa will be preaching, and her sister, Kristen Lee, will be joining her in music. And Kristen has shared music before during this service, and it's always a treat and a delight. We normally have a First Friday meditation every month. And because I'm going to Florida, I moved it to a Good Friday meditation. Notice how nice that worked out. So we're doing it on April the 15th, on Friday, on Zoom at 7 o'clock. And it'll be pretty much the same format that we use every month. You're all invited to join us. We will have, what?
Oh, I just couldn't resist after you get your taxes done, right? April 15th.
I wasn't planning to do it. Oh, a mood buster. On the 17th, our Easter service will be here in person. Then we are having a Lenten outreach program, which we do every year. And for the second year in a row, what we're doing is collecting money to give to the HART program. And H-A-R-T stands for the Homeless Assistance Resource Team. It is in Citrus Heights. They do really good work with the homeless population here in Citrus Heights. We have an envelope, just a plain white anonymous envelope on the table in the lobby if you would like to give a donation in it. And if you want us to record that donation for your tax purposes, just write on the outside of the envelope your name and how much you gave. The last Sunday we'll be collecting for HART will be Easter Sunday. Is that, you know, it's a Lenten outreach. It's a wonderful organization. We're proud to do it. There are other ways, you know, you can give. You can just write it on any check on your memo line, or go on our website, tell us it's what it's for. It's easy. And then, as we do every week, sometimes on Zoom and sometimes in person, we invite you to stay and chat after the service. We've got some goodies and coffee ready to go. So we'll be gathering around a table or two and getting to know each other when the service is done. And now we invite everybody to stand as Lisa leads us in singing the peace song.